Okay, take 36. Hello, welcome. Welcome to my home. If you're watching this video, it means you probably just watched BattleBots Season 6, Episode 2, and if you're anything like me, you're probably wondering, what the heck just happened? So, spoiler alert, turn back now, because I'm going to tell you all about what happened, why it happened, and how we fixed it. That's right, I am spilling all of the tea. Maybe I'll have some outtakes. So if you haven't watched Season 6, Episode 2, turn this off, go catch up. It's on Discovery, Discovery Plus, and Amazon. I'll be here. You can come back later. Okay, if you're still watching, I'm assuming that you're into this, so here we go. In order to understand the choices that we made on the drive that led to the incident, we actually have to go back to our first fight of Season 5. Story time. In the debut fight for the all-new HiJinx, we fought Claw Viper. Claw Viper is a control bot with a stout body. It has magnets on the bottom for additional grip and speed. It's a very good, fast robot. But for the first half of that fight, I was actually really happy with how things were going. The essentially untested HiJinx was doing what it was supposed to do. Claw Viper was running up over our defenses, just as we had hoped they would, and they were taking hits to the body and the weapon. So from my perspective, things looked pretty good. You know, until they didn't. I saw one of the drive wheels on HiJinx was cogging a bit, concern.gif, but we were still moving. Now, there was a moment off camera where Claw Viper's weapon was effectively disabled and they were kind of like stuck, like wrapped around our wing. The fight was paused, the robots were unstuck, and then the fight resumed, only at that point HiJinx was no longer moving in what we would call a controlled manner. No, I was shouting at Kevin, trying to get Claw Viper to come and attack HiJinx. He was not taking the bait. Countdown started. The fight was over. And then we went back to the pit to figure out what happened. What had happened was, on one gearbox, one of the planetary gears had just crunched entirely. And on the other gearbox, the sun gear had sheared off. So why did that happen? Well, the short answer is Newton's third law. One thing that we just cannot safely test in the shop is what happens to the drive when the weapon is spun up to full and makes contact with something. For drive tests, which we did extensively in March of 2020, we install a safety disc. This is a 69-pound disc that has no teeth, and it mimics the mass distribution and therefore the moment of inertia of our weapon bars. For weapon tests, we use the same safety disc and we put barriers up around HiJinx and then we go far away so that we're not anywhere near the spinning robot, because even the safety disc will kick up debris off of the ground. What we cannot do is we cannot drive and hit things. It's just not safe. Nevertheless, thanks to physics, we can calculate how much energy is stored in the weapon as it spins up. So for those of you playing along at home, there are 68 pounds of mass in the stout bar, and it's 42 inches in length, so you can take half of that from the axle, and it has a tip speed of 200 miles per hour. So what we're talking about now is rotational kinetic energy. Don't skip class, kids. And by our napkin math, a fully dangerous HiJinx weapon is delivering 20 to 40 kilojoules of energy. That is non-trivial, okay? To compare, a bullet from a rifle can have 2,000 to 4,000 joules. That's 4 kilojoules. HiJinx does 40 kilojoules. What makes a bullet so dangerous is that the energy is concentrated to a very small point. And with HiJinx, obviously it's spread over a larger area. But I guess also this is the time I should mention that we use AR-400 steel for the HiJinx armor and AR-500 steel for the weapon bars. AR is abrasion resistant steel, and the number is the hardness on the Brinell scale. So this is a high-carbon manganese steel that's used to stop bullets at firing ranges. It is used to armor tanks. Our sponsor, Van Bebber Brothers, whom we love, gifts us this wonderful material at cost, but it needs must be remarked, BattleBots are incredibly dangerous to test without safety containment. Although, if you know someone in California who has a facility where we can test this safely, drop a link in the comments, I would love to talk to you. Back to Newton's third law. Every reaction has an equal and opposite reaction. How we make contact with the other robot is a huge variable for how much energy is transferred from our weapon to their body. Sometimes you get a glancing blow, not a lot of energy transferred. Sometimes you get a big hit. But no matter what, anytime the weapon makes contact with the other robot, there will be some energy that must go back into our robot. We have to be able to tank our own hits. Honestly, this is why big bar spinners are sometimes called glass cannons, because so much of the available weight is sunk into the weapon system that there isn't a lot left over for structure. I think we do a pretty good job on this because we have a monocoque AR-400 chassis. But the fact remains that big spinners can damage themselves as much as their opponent. And part of our strategy to handle this energy is to make the chassis and mechanical assemblies so strong that HiJinx can throw itself across the arena without taking much damage. And as you saw in the Mammoth fight, our baby can do a kickflip off the shelf from 10 feet up. Not a big deal. Oh, but back to the Claw Viper fight. HiJinx didn't really throw herself the way that we were expecting. In fact, when the wheels and tail were on the ground, she kind of planted on the wheels. Which was a big problem because of how we had designed the drive. In Season 5, we were using Castle brushless motors for the drive with a BattleBots gearbox, and the gear reduction was close to 100-1, and that choice was made to take advantage of translating the energy from a very fast spinning motor to a slower spin with higher torque at the wheel. So the motor spins freely very fast, and we gear that down to get reliable torque. Changing the gear ratio in a system can have a huge influence on speed and power, and for brushless motors, a good gear ratio can help prevent cogging and motor stalling at startup. But, the force from HiJinx hitting Claw Viper came back through the planted wheels and into the drive. We were basically slamming and backdriving the wheels every time we made a hit, and that really rapidly damaged the gearboxes. And, because it's BattleBots, we had zero time in the pits to make the system work better before our next fight. Not a problem, though, because we are very clever. Sometimes. Orion is very clever. Orion Beach designed a really rad clamp clutch for the HiJinx weapon stack, and it works so good. Unlike torque limiters, which I hate, or mechanical clutches, which can get really large, the principle here is fairly simple. The top collar is clamped with even force around a smooth 4140 steel shaft, and the central aluminum gear of the direct drive system is bolted to the clamp. So if we have a truly gigantic hit, the lion's share of the energy goes into our opponent, and the return force is absorbed and dissipated by the slip of the clamp clutch and the flex of the chassis. It is so good. I had purchased lightened racing hubs for HiJinx. They were something that I had used on go-karts for a while, so I thought that they would be all right. And, as you can see, we have through hardware to hold the wheel and the backing plate on, we've got more hardware to clamp the hub around the drive shaft, and there's a keyway which aligns with the keyed shaft to lock the movement from the shaft to the hub. So, if we have hardware to hold the thing that moves, and the thing that it needs to move, and we want to dissipate some energy on the hits, well, we could totally take the key stock out of the keyway and let the clamping hardware act like a clamp clutch. I'm gonna take a sip of tea real quick. That's good tea. Listen, if it's stupid but it works, it's not stupid. So, oh boy. But once you have the keys out and the hubs are slipping, now you've created a new problem. Can you guess? It's the keyway. The anodized aluminum is much softer than the drive shaft, which is 4140 steel, and that keyway galls the hub every time it slips, so the aluminum hubs basically become a consumable. We have to anticipate possibly losing two every fight. And while the hubs I chose were fine, essentially, Orion also pointed out a serious potential problem in acquiring spares. The manufacturing runs on these parts don't always generate identical components, because for go-kart racing, what matters is the hardware location, not the overall profile of the hub. We even had a machining issue in Season 5. The wheels had a void cutout that was the shape of the hub, and the idea was to take shear load off of the hardware and put it on the body of the hub. Our teammate in New Jersey wound up with a different hub from the same website, so we had different CAD models for the hubs, and the hub pattern cut into the wheel was larger than the lightened racing hubs I had actually bought. And in this case, close is not close enough. I wish BattleBots had given me one of these, but I actually had to buy it. I got a discount. For being a fan! Composure. I have composure. Okay, where was I? So you can imagine, the worst case scenario for this is that we're doing really well at BattleBots. And then we destroy all of the hubs, and we can't get any more. And we can't easily make them on site. So we have to back out of the tournament because Auntie Jen was trying to save a few ounces of weight on the drive hubs. See, these are the thoughts that keep me up at night. So at a minimum, we need a simplified hub. Something with fewer machining operations. Something we could make ourselves in a pinch. Skip anodizing, make them identical, make at least 16 of them, so that if we trashed a pair in every match, we would still be able to fight in the tournament. Really trying to be prepared here on a shoestring budget. Well, thank my lucky stars, we have P3D Creations and Integrated Motion Systems as machining sponsors because thanks to their generous sponsorship, we were able to do a lot of the redesign for HiJinx in-house this year. And in addition to changing the hubs, buying all new wheels, we also beefed up the gearbox to a P8X, which has a 16-to-1 gear reduction, and the motors were upgraded to the Flip Sky 6374, and the final stage of the drive had a ratio of 18-to-12. So the overall gear ratio had changed from 100-to-1 down to 24-to-1, which is a lot more sane, I think. It's reasonable. So there's a lot less danger from back driving, both while we're moving the robot to and from the arena and in the matches. This is better. It's all better. So if we have all these upgrades, what went wrong? Yeah, I was going to try to do the whole video without my glasses, but I have myopia, which is true and also a metaphor. Anyway, so if we have all of these upgrades, what went wrong? Well, after the fight, I checked on the drive shaft. All of the threads were intact, and I looked at the bolt, assuming that it must have sheared, and all of the threads were intact. So there was no damage. We did upgrade the hardware that captures the wheel for this season from 5/16-24 to half 20, and oh no. So if you have a bolt that's really stuck, what is the tool that you would reach for to unstick it? You'd grab an impact driver, yeah? Yeah. The bolt unscrewed. I just need to, Okay. Every time HiJinx hit the ground running, that was a lot like an impact plus a rotation, which is a lot like the action of an impact driver. And it didn't matter that we'd used Threadlocker, and it didn't matter that we'd never had this problem before. This is what happened. The spinning wheel smacking on the ground had enough force to break the Threadlocker and push the bolt back out. The gosh darn thing unscrewed. Tragedy. Massive oversight. My soul left my body. I died. I'm dead. I can't come back from this. Well, yeah, I can. Oh, it's so bad. And look, I am not going to throw Orion Beach under the bus here. That dude has done the vast share of the design work on HiJinx for 2 seasons, and part of my job is to verify my team's work and give my own expert eye. And I missed this. There are 4 of us on the team, all engineers. All of us looked at this hardware and said, yeah, that'll work. And for season 5, it did work. And then our luck ran out. Oh, speaking of luck, can we talk about Mammoth for a second? How is he, though? Almost got his upright frame cut in half. Also, Ricky, thanks for letting us take pictures after the match. Really appreciate that. All right, so we failed, and that sucks. But the important thing is, how do we fix it? Well, let me tell you. In the pits, after the Mammoth fight, we changed the stack up for the capture hardware. We added a thrust washer, we added red Loctite, we changed the torque spec, and that worked for the rest of Season 6. We did not have this failure again, okay? For so many reasons, for the waste of throwing away hubs, for the danger of vibration and impact, I do not like the solution long term. I'm just not happy with the drive hardware, so I want to make a big change for season 7. I'm going to take a sip of tea. There are a lot of ways to solve this problem, but I'm going to tell you what my favorite solution so far is, and it is the castellated nut. Are you familiar with this? Let me tell you all about it. My background, outside of art and robots, includes cars, racing, and airplanes, so it won't surprise the gearheads out there that I want to try a castellated nut. This is something that we've used in automotive for a long time to keep nuts from backing out in high-vibration components like tie rod assemblies or control arms, and in aviation we have a similar hardware concept called safety wire. With safety wire, you want to use the tension of two or more bolts that are threaded together to keep the bolts from backing out. So this is less useful for HiJinx because we're dealing with a terminal bolt, but if we redesign the drive shafts and change the innie to an outie, the castle nut and cotter pin solution would totally work. And we'd be getting rid of the keyway that galls the hubs and trashes them every fight. Honestly, if you had asked me last year if we needed something like a castle nut or a wired bolt for the drive, I would have said no. I would have said that's overkill. We're over-engineering. I mean, how much vibration can you get in 3 minutes? Oh, we have fun. But the answer is enough. You can get enough vibration or impact in 3 minutes to unscrew your wheel or anything else, probably. That's part of the reality we have to live with. So, while a castle nut is not the only option, it is my current favorite. It's kind of a simple solution that's already been proven in industry, and I like things that are proven in industry. That would mean that HiJinx would need custom drive shafts for season 7, and we wouldn't be able to make those in-house. Hey, if you know someone who would like to sponsor us for custom drive shafts for season 7, drop a link in the comments, bestie, I want to talk to you. I like 17.4 pH for the surface finish, but I can also do 4140. That's worked out for us so far. So far? I mean, to sum up, it hurts to lose this way. And it's definitely not the result that we wanted, but it is an inspiration to continue making the robot better every time. Failure is weakness leaving the robot, and we have a whole season of BattleBots to look forward to, so stay tuned.